devotion selected for today's message is from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 onwards. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." Let's close our eyes. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful time of praise and worship. Thank you, Lord, for helping us to be here this morning, this beautiful morning, this beautiful Sunday morning. Thank you, Lord, for all your faithful children who are seated here. Thank you, Lord, for the beautiful moment of prayer that we just had. Thank you, Lord, for your presence right now, right here in our midst. Lord, we commit and submit every one of us, including me, to your mighty, mighty hands. Unworthy as I am, Lord, strengthen me as I speak from your word. And Lord, I just pray, we all just pray that you speak to us about what being a part of your holy body and holy blood is all about. Being a part of what communion is all about. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' precious name. Well, it was nice to be a part of the communion service, which began at 9. Though we didn't have as many of our members or our faithful ones during that time. I said during the communion service that I was looking forward to being a part of the Crossway worship. But I come from the Mathew Samuel of Dallas Farmers Branch. And something about me, I'm Mathew Samuel. I have two kids here, Elijah and Elisha, 11, 12 and 9. Two kids, one wife. So she's gone, she's in Oklahoma, she's gone to speak in Oklahoma Church, and she's been speaking for the last 2 days, Friday, Saturday and Sunday. She'll be returning back today night. In fact, all four of us wanted to come here together. That was our intention, that was our interest. But it so happened that the Oklahoma Church, they called Trina for the retreat there. They had three organizational retreats. So each day one organization retreat. And that's how she happened to be here, and we three are here. But anyhow, one day, I'm sure God would give us the opportunity to be here, all four of us together. Right from the time the Crossway worship started, it's something of a great interest to me. And I've heard a great deal of what Crossway is and could be from our previous diocesan bishop, Theodosius Firmini. So Firmini had given me a good idea or a good picture of what Crossway is and could be moving ahead in the future. So from that time onwards, I was inspired by what Firmini had to say, and from that time onwards, I was looking forward to be a part of this community, this worshiping community. And as I said in the morning, it was good that Mathew Joseph went on leave, and it's because of that I could be here with you. Everything happens for the good. So I could be here with you today, worshiping our loving, merciful, all-powerful Heavenly Father. Now, before I came in here and joined the worship, I was given a brief idea of what the worship would be like by Nivin. So Nivin gave me a picture of what it is and what I need to do during the Kurbana service and the worship service. And then I'm grateful to you too for helping me out. And so Nivin also told me that it's good that if you could stick on one theme, and the theme that he prefers would be on the communion, the Holy Communion. And so, according to the instructions that I received from Nivin, here I am with a brief idea of what the Holy Communion is. That's better. So what Holy Communion is. Now, before I move on to a picture, what we could adopt in having the Holy Communion, let me answer two questions. One, why do we observe Holy Communion? Why do we observe Holy Communion? And second, how often should Holy Communion be held? One, why do we observe Holy Communion? Holy Communion, communion, community, fellowship, it's coming together, the whole church coming together. It's not an individual affair, it's not a family affair, it's the whole community, the Crossway community, the Marathon community coming together to be a part of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. The body and blood of Jesus Christ. We observe communion because it is one of the direct command of our Lord. Just because the Lord told us so by His own lips. In observing communion, we are remembering Christ and all that He has done for us through His life, through His death and resurrection, and looking forward to His second coming again. So when we observe communion, we show our participation in the body of Christ. His life becomes our life. And we become members of each other. As I said, it's a corporate affair. It's a community affair. It's an affair where all the faithful, they come together and experience this joy of sharing in the body and blood of Christ. Almost all churches universally, they observe, almost all churches, they observe seven sacraments. And sacraments, as we know, it is a means, it is a way through which we receive the grace of God. Not that we don't receive grace of God by any other means in our daily lives or through prayers or through our devotional time with God. But these are the church moments. These are the moments that the church observes, where the church and the faithful together, they receive the grace of God. And of all these seven sacraments, two sacraments have been such that they have been instituted by the Lord Himself. One is the holy baptism, and second is the holy communion. So baptism and communion are the two sacraments that have been instituted by the very lips, by our very Lord, by Lord Jesus Himself. And that's why, and that's precisely why we observe them in our churches as sacraments. So the next question, how often should we have Holy Communion? Or how often should Holy Communion be held? Well, what it's written here is that for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. No frequency is given. Nowhere in the New Testament, we don't find any frequency. A week, a month, a year, no such frequency is given. But what it says is, as often as you eat this bread, meaning that the church at Corinth, the portion that I took from, the church at Corinth observed it frequently. As often as we are willing to remember and to proclaim the life and death and resurrection of Christ, we have to celebrate the communion. It's also a testimony to the world. And what is that testimony? That we are not ashamed of our Lord and of His blood, and that we belong as a community, as a faithful community, we belong to Him, and we are obedient to what He has said, and He wants us to go through. Done frequently, Paul sets certain do's and don'ts that the church has to observe while in communion. So that's what we see in word from verse 27 onwards, 27, 28, and 29 onwards. So there are certain do's and don'ts. You need to observe Holy Communion, but you need to always also be careful about certain things that you need to observe during your observance of the Holy Communion. Remember, one thing we should remember, that the nearer a person comes to light, the more he gets light. The closer he gets to fire, the warmer he gets. The more he nears himself to sanctity, the more saintly, the more better the person is able to live. In the same way, the more often one draws near to God and through His communion, the more he receives the light, the more he receives the warmth, and more better the person is able to live himself. Do this in remembrance of me is a direct command from the lips of the Lord Himself. So sharing in Lord's Supper is therefore not an option for the believer. It is always good to have communion on a regular basis. It's always better. Now, I also happen to read a good writer with which I was attracted, that impressed me. And I want to share certain insights from the writer that I happened to read. And this writer was written by a famous theologian, Herman Abrahams. And in this writer, he speaks about a fourfold look at what Holy Communion is. How, when we come for the Holy Communion, we need to perceive or see or take in the Holy Communion for ourselves. Very often, not going on very often, at least sometimes, we would be callous or not very careful enough when we come before the altar for the Holy Communion. We might not take it as seriously as it should be. And since the prayers are all written prayers, probably we might feel it's something routine or it's something very regular. And sometimes it happens that it loses its meaning. But let me say that When you go through each prayer intently, when you go through each aspect of the Holy Communion very minutely, very seriously, you would know the beauty of what the Holy Communion is all about. Just because it has a written set of prayers doesn't make it any less serious enough. And as we involve ourselves, as I said during my first sermon, that each time I come for the Holy Communion, I come with trembling. I come with fear. The fear, the trembling, because I feel that I'm not worthy enough to lead the congregation. And each time I come with fear, this is in me that, Lord, I am sinful. More sinful than your faithful children sitting here. But how am I qualified to lead the Holy Communion? But Lord, I place myself into your hands. And when I go through that motion, when I go through each prayer intently, with a serious purpose, I can feel the joy, the presence of the Lord. And I'm sure that's the experience when each faithful person, we come before the Lord, and when we experience this Holy Communion intently and seriously enough, we experience that grace, that presence, that moving presence in and through us. So what Abraham says is, one, that every Holy Communion is looking back to the past of what has happened. Every Holy Communion is looking back to a past of what has really happened before. And here it says in verse 24, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. It's going back to the past. And in verse 26, it says, you proclaim the Lord's death. Again, it's going to the past. You go back to the past when the Lord lived, and the Lord lived, and when the Lord gave up himself for me and for you. So it is a look to the past. It is a looking back to the past that should give a little more meaning to the present taking in of the Holy Communion, or observing of the Holy Communion. You look to the past when Christ lived. You look to the past what Christ taught. You look to the past how Christ suffered. You look to the past how Christ gave up his life very painfully, very shamefully, very painfully for me and for him. Taking up all the shame of the world. Taking up all the pain of the world. It's a looking back to what really happened. And each time I come before you, each time when we come before you, this communion should take me back to the 2,000 years of our Lord's history. So our communion takes right. If you go to the communion from beginning till the end, it begins right from the birth of Jesus Christ through Mary, mother of Jesus. It takes you right from the birth through Mary, through his life, teachings, and on to his suffering, to his death, and to his ascension, the hope of his coming again. So the entire Christ episode is played out each time you are becoming a part of the Holy Communion. The entire Christ episode, you and me, we've been part of the entire Christ episode, right from the beginning till the time he was taken up to heaven. That whole episode is being played out each time you are a part of the Holy Communion. Secondly, he says that every Holy Communion is also looking within ourselves. Every Holy Communion is a looking within ourselves. First I said, every Holy Communion is looking back to the past. And secondly, every Holy Communion is a looking within. So in verse 28, it says, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat the bread. Everyone ought to examine themselves. What does it mean? It simply means every Holy Communion is also a time of self-evaluation. Every Holy Communion is also a time of self-evaluation. During the Holy Communion, the message I gave was from Isaiah. How Isaiah encounters God. How Isaiah encounters God and what really happens to him. So in there, Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 following, in there, Isaiah has a holiness of God. Isaiah sees the holiness, has a vision of the holiness of God. Verse 2 and 3. And what after the encounter with the holy God, what happens is he becomes very self-evaluating. Very self-evaluating. And he says, I'm a sinful man. I'm a sinful man living among a sinful people. He becomes self-evaluating. He evaluates himself. So what happens is, when he comes before the presence of God, what he does next is evaluate himself. Evaluate who he is. Where do I stand before the majesty of the law? Where do I stand myself before the holiness of God? What is my personality as such? Am I matching up to what God really wants to be? It's a time to self-evaluate. It's a time to examine ourselves. And after Isaiah has his time of self-evaluation, you know what happens? Next thing what happens is, when he confesses his sins before the Lord touches him. An angel takes a coal, burning coal, from up above, comes down, touches the lips, touches the body of Isaiah, and says, now you have become holy. Most of the time, I compare that burning coal with Jesus himself. Jesus, exactly the same way, is the one who comes down from heaven, who came down from heaven. And when he meets me, and when I meet him, and when I confess myself before him, he really touches me. And when he touches me, what he says is, you have become whole. And when you have that touch from God, and it is important that we have that touch from God, you live a worthy life. You live a worthy life. But only when we allow ourselves to be touched by this heavenly Savior, the burning coal. Only when I allow myself to be touched by this burning coal, this Jesus Christ, will I be touched by him. And when I am touched by him, That's it. That's the greatness, that's the beauty, that's the fulfillment of our lives. And it is important that we have a touch from up above. And here it says that you need to examine ourselves. It's a time of self-examination. Each time I come before the Holy God, each time I come before His presence, each time I come before the Holy Communion, it's a time to examine ourselves, to confess myself before him. And he is worthy enough and he's merciful enough to accept my confession and forgive me my sins and take me as a man. Thirdly, every Holy Communion according to him is also a call to look around. First I said it's a looking back. Second I said it's a looking within. And third, it's also a looking around. A looking around me. So, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 17, it says that, because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. We who are many. So you don't come here in isolation. You don't come here as an island by yourself. You come here, though a different individual, but when you are here, you're all part of this great one body of Christ. So it's also very important that I look around me who are around me. I need to remember that I am in communion with all of these saintly, all of these faithful people who are around me. And that gives me a sense of community. And that sense of community was very important. The early church, the other churches, they also for the present. And when I don't have a community feeling, I feel that, well, I am outside of this circle. And when I feel that I am welcome, when I feel that I am a part of this community, and I feel a special feeling. And that can only be had when you look around us and you involve everybody, you welcome everybody, you accept everybody, you take in everybody within this community. So it's also a community affair. Looking around, and trying to get involved as many people, or trying to invite others into this brotherhood or sisterhood community. It's a brotherhood community. It's a sister community. We are a community of Jesus Christ. And within this community, there is no they and us. It's always us. Us with the law. This is very important. So it's a time of communion with others. So we are connected not just with the Lord who saved us, but with even the past believers who have gone before us. And the present faithful who are sitting beside us and being part of this community. Fourthly, he says, every communion is also looking ahead. First, it's a looking back. Second, it's a looking within. Third, it's a looking around. And fourth, it's a looking ahead. What do we look at? What do we look ahead for? It's a looking ahead into the future. What about the future? In 1 Corinthians chapter 11 verse 26, it says, until he comes. We're looking ahead of a time when Christ is going to come again for the second time. So every communion is a reminder of the Lord's second coming. Is coming again. It's celebrating his present life and his future return in glory. This is very important. And here again Jesus says that I will not have tasted of this blood of this bread and wine until I come again to make you mine. Which means he's going to come again. And we are looking forward to his coming again. And each communion is a reminder that he's going to come again. Each communion is a reminder that we are looking forward to his coming again when he is going to make us his own and join us into his sheepfold and take us to heaven. This is what he has promised. And his promise has never gone wrong. And what's the promise? That he's going to come again. And we celebrate that hope. We celebrate that looking forward each time when we be a part of this holy communion of the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Well, let me conclude. First, I said, why do we observe the holy communion? The answer, just because it's the direct command of the Lord from his own lips. And second, I asked the question, how often should we have holy communion? As often as we can. It says here, as often as you eat this bread, as often as you can. And then I went on to explain a fourfold view of what the communion is all about. First I said, as I'm looking back to the past. What about the past? Of the past event when Christ was born, lived, died, suffered, died, and rose again, and ascended into heaven. Secondly, I said, it's a looking within. What about that? Looking within, examining myself, examining where I stand. Do I really rise up to how Christ wants me to live? Christ has an expectation. And do I live according to that expectation? And thirdly, I said, it's a looking around. It's a looking around me. It's a looking around me when I feel that I'm not an individual person, an isolated person. I am a part of the community. I am a part of the community. I'm a part of a faithful body, the brotherhood, the sisterhood community of Jesus Christ. And finally, I said, it's a time to look ahead. It's a time to look into the future. It's a time to look into the future when we are promised the coming back of our Lord. And it says, until the time of Christ coming again, we need to observe this Holy Communion. That's what the Word of God says. Until the time when it comes again for the second time, we keep on observing the communion, being a part of the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Just that we need to seriously prepare ourselves each moment or each Sunday we come for the Holy Communion. Preparation wouldn't mean preparing yourself on Sunday morning after you. But we as a family, children, we start from the Saturday night itself, preparing through our prayers, our talks, to be part of this. And that gives all the more a special feeling, not just when you enter the sanctuary and when the communion is going on, you just, without being mindful of anything, you just become a part of the Holy Communion. It doesn't mean anything to anybody, anything to anyone. It's only when we have a spiritual preparation, a prayerful preparation, that it becomes meaningful. And for that matter, anything here has meaning only when you give meaning to it. Everything would be meaningless when you don't give meaning to it. It is all about our mind. It is all about our spirit. Everything has meaning only when you give meaning to it. If you don't give meaning, nothing would make sense to anybody, especially to us. So, when we come to the Holy Communion, pray, prepare, and participate. That's very important. May these words enlighten us. May these words help us. And may these words guide us as we become part of the Holy Communion in the coming Sundays. Thank you. Thank you so much. God bless you. Can I ask one of us to read? Thank you.